Well, I was hired about 4 years ago in the summer of 2007, at a time that admittedly was very different than it is now at the New York Times. There were fewer bloggers, fewer web producers, less of an emphasis on the web. But the Times has never been as backwards as people think about the web. You know, as early as 1995, there was a functioning website, and by the time I arrived there, there were already dozens of blogs. So I was coming in really, for me, at the right time, because I was coming in as the Times was really bulking up and staffing up for the internet revolution, for the online revolution. The Times hired me out of college because I had a blog called TV Newser that I ran from my dorm room here, actually in Maryland, at Towson University. So the Times hired me to keep covering television, but to cover it more broadly, and to cover it both for the print edition as well as the website. And going forward, that's really the way that many people at the Times function. We will be working on stories for the website during the day, and then at the end of the day, work them into the print edition. And of course, they're still online all the time. That interplay between print and web, you know, has worked out really beautifully, I think, in my time there. You know, I think that there's a handful of people at the Times, probably myself included, that have encouraged social media, especially Twitter. You know, when we say social media, what we really mean is Twitter, and then to a lesser extent, Facebook and other sites. Because I was on Twitter so early, I think I probably encouraged use of it in the newsroom a little bit. But it really ends up being every person's, every reporter's, and every editor's decision to make, you know, whether they want to be on the site or not. I love Twitter because to me it's an early warning system for breaking news. And for me it's a great way to respond to readers and hear what readers want me to work on, hear what they think, hear their compliments, hear their criticisms. So for me it's really powerful. And I think, you know, we're at the point now where it seems like all the reporters on a lot of beats are on Twitter. You know, so on the media desk, I think almost every reporter at the time is using Twitter every day. So it's been a gradual ramp up. And, you know, I think having people like me on there early probably showed that it was viable. You know, the danger with these sites is always that it's going to be a distraction, that it's going to take up your time, that it's going to end up hurting your day job in some way. And I think people like me and David Carr showed that, you know, you could balance all those platforms pretty effectively.
Hi, I'm Kate Novack. I'm the producer and writer with director Andrew Rossi of Page One Inside the New York Times. And we really went inside the New York Times because we were developing a film for television on Web 2.0, the sort of young guns who were a new breed of internet entrepreneurs. And as part of that project, Andrew went to the New York Times and interviewed David Carr, who would become the breakout star of Page One, but that day he was there to interview him for the television project on Web 2.0. And in the process of interviewing David, we thought, we want to make a movie about this place and about the stakes for journalism in a digital era, and really saw that there was this moment of peril but also of opportunity. And so that was the impetus for Page One. Yeah, there was a very sort of apocalyptic moment when we started filming. You had lots of people saying that there may have to be, you know, dead bodies on the side of the road on the way to the digital future. You know, and the story is still being written. But, you know, what we try to show in the film is an institution that really is committed to original reporting. And that, you know, that sustained commitment, I think, is what maintains the importance of the New York Times brand. Yeah, I mean, I think definitely, you know, we never expected that we would capture the emergence of WikiLeaks as such a force in the news landscape. And, you know, we interviewed Susan Shearer, the foreign editor for the New York Times, sort of after the Times had, you know, used WikiLeaks as a source pretty extensively. And one of the things she said to us was, you know, we're all a lot more humble about what we can control. And I think that is one of the developments, and it's, you know, it's not necessarily a bad thing. So, you know, it was one of the, you know, like the diplomatic cables was one of the biggest journalistic scoops of the past 30 years. So, you know, it was really this treasure trove of information. One of the things that we really try to do in the film is to bring an intimacy to a very, you know, big kind of fortress-like institution. And David Carr, who's the main character of Page One, I think kind of defies traditional expectations of, you know, the quote-unquote Timesman. And so that's one of the great things, is you really see this character who really takes no BS, but also is totally committed to original boots-on-the-ground reporting.
The Nobody had to convince me. It's the way the world is going. I was at South by Southwest, and the primary news vehicle was Twitter, and it's not like if I'm going to be a part of the conversation, I'm going to be a part of that conversation wherever it's occurring. If it's on the web, if it's on Facebook, if it's on Twitter, or if it's on a flip cam.